Hello learners, we are again here to discuss the topic learning in art, health and physical and work education at elementary level. Now, today we will discuss unit 7, school health education program. The learning objectives of this lesson is that after reading this lesson, the student will be able to explain the importance of safe drinking water and safe food, state about proper lighting, ventilation and comfortable sitting arrangement. Create positive emotional and social environment in the class. So, we have discussed the learning objectives. Now, let's discuss the healthful in school environment. A school is an important and basic unit of the society. A good school with healthful environment is the foundation on which the society is based. In the school environment, child learns to eat, play, share and care, make new friends. He becomes familiar with eating habits, food, cleanliness, hygiene and so many other things. School authorities and teachers should take care of all these aspects. Now let's discuss the clean drinking water supply in schools. Main sources of drinking water are wells, rivers, ponds, hand pumps, taps, etc. Nowadays, water is polluted by washing clothes and utensils, throwing waste, drainage of chemicals and performing some rituals in the rivers. In urban cities, there are many methods to get clean water with the help of RO system and other purifying systems, etc. In schools, there should be provision of safe drinking water, covered storage of water, be adequate drinking water according to the school strength. In urban cities, municipal corporation plays major role in supplying clean drinking water to schools. We should be particular that in every school, the water storage tanks are cleaned regularly. Special records are kept for the cleaning. Water purifier and chlorine tablets are provided by the school authorities. Teachers should give regular practice of not wasting water and reusing it for gardening, cleaning floors, etc. There should be provision of clean toilets and urinals in the schools also. Schools are the centers to make children learn about the importance of hygiene. Necessary sanitation facilities should be made available in the schools. In this regard, school authorities and teachers have significant roles to play. Now let's discuss the role of school authorities. First, separate toilet blocks for girls in co-ed schools. Children must feel safe when visiting the facility without having risk for harassment, attack by animals like snakes in rural areas. Proper locking system should be there. It means there should be bolts and handles. Supervisions by attendants in case of pre-primary girl child. Sanitation facility should not contaminate groundwater. Toilet block should be cleaned twice a day. Toilet and urinals should be physical challenge friendly, having low level and handrails and ramps. Lighting and ventilation should be proper. Water supply should be adequate. Monitor regular use of toilet cleaners. So, what is safe food? Let's discuss about safe food. Children bring food from home for lunch break. They are getting midday meals also in the schools. In some schools, there are cafeterias too. Safe food is very important for children to keep them healthy and away from diseases. Hand washing facility. Children are taught to wash hands before and after meals. Teachers should also encourage them to wash hands even after handling animals, throwing garbage, visiting sick, after playing, sneezing, coughing, using toilets and urinals. Some provisions have to be made in schools as proper and continuous supply of water, child-friendly wash basins at minimum height, proper arrangement of soaps and hand wash liquid. Pre-primary students must be accompanied by teacher or nanny. Now let's discuss about the drainage system, how it should be in schools. Proper drainage system is the need of every school to keep the environment healthy and clean. If drainage system is not well maintained, mosquitoes will breed freely in dirty and clogged water, and there will be common diseases like malaria, dengue, etc. It will increase absenteeism. The school authorities and teachers have a separate role to play to make the school environment friendly. Now let's discuss about the steps that should be taken by school authorities. The steps taken by the school authorities are: number one, covering of the drains so that there are no casualties. Regular cleaning of drains by local bodies to avoid blockage. Number three, regular repair of the pipelines to avoid water clogging. Next, regular use of disinfectants, pesticides and insecticides to avoid the breeding of insects. In this case, the teacher is to be attentive about: no child should play near uncovered drain to avoid casualties. No child should throw any object like ball, stones, plastic bags and handkerchief into the drain to avoid blockage. No child should play with dirty clogged water. In rural areas where there are fewer facilities, teachers have to be more careful. We can overcome this with coordinated and combined effort of school authorities, local governing bodies, parents, teachers and students. They have a very important role for maintaining the cleanliness around them. Now let's discuss about the refuse disposal. Fast development and flow from rural to urban have contributed to unhealthy environment in the metros, like air and water pollution. The waste disposal is also one of the major problems. This can be easily controlled when we start taking initiative at the school level. We can manage waste by 4 R's, that is refuse, reuse, reduce and recycle. An activity can also be done in the class. Like, for example, the teacher can place 3 separate dustbin in the class, namely A, B and C. The dustbin which names A is for the leftover food, B is for only papers, and the third dustbin, which is C, is for plastics, polythene and metals. Ask your children to identify the waste and throw in the bin according to the material. Put waste of A in compost pit to prepare manure by adding garden soil, dried leaves and twigs. Put waste of B in water, add plaster of Paris, tissue paper and prepare different paper mache items like fruits, vegetables, pencil stands, etc. For waste C, we can tell them that plastic material and poly bags are very harmful for our environment. After burning, they release harmful carbon dioxide. It should not be burned, rather sold out for recycling. Hand washing area should be cleaned regularly with cleansers. Wash basins should be according to school strength. And in rural areas, water buckets, soaps and mugs must be kept. Let's discuss about the lighting, how it should be in schools. Visual environment is very important for learners' ability and mental attitude. Proper lighting improves in respiration, heart action and brain activity, whereas dim light reverse effects as sleep being facilitated. In rural areas, some schools are in open and children don't face light problem. In urban areas, classrooms should have adequate lighting arrangements, having 4-5 tubes in the room. Classrooms should have warm color paints and walls to give more lighting effect. Teachers should be careful about lighting. Before starting the day, she should make sure that lights are on, electrical wires should be checked regularly and replaced with new ones if damaged. Electrical repairs should be done timely. Child having visual problems should be made seated where maximum light is available. Let's discuss about the ventilation system. Wherever we sit, stand or sleep, proper ventilation is required. Windows are the cheap and efficient solution for fresh air and climate control in schools. Children in well-ventilated classrooms perform better than their peers who get inadequate fresh air. In urban areas, It experiences these problems more than rural areas. In rural areas, the classrooms are in open or in tents, whereas in urban areas, schools are in buildings, so ventilation is a hazard. Schools should have proper ventilation in classrooms with proper windows so that the classrooms are neither too hot in summers nor too cold in winters. There should be comfortable sitting arrangement also. To make the learning more effective, comfortable sitting arrangement should be done in the class. Teacher can put her best to be comfortable and approachable to every child. Like in elementary classes, there should be different sitting arrangement according to the activities to be done in the class, like group work, group discussion, writing work, performing art, etc. Teacher should be more careful about the sitting arrangement of the child with a special need. If teacher is having children with a special need or visual auditory problem child, he or she has to arrange their seats accordingly. Sitting arrangement is as under. Group work sitting arrangement should be in clumps or cluster. Group discussion, teacher should have eye contact with every child. And in writing work, every child should have clear view of the blackboard. Performing art, children should be given enough space. Child with a special need should be seated near the door. Troublemakers, they should be seated near teacher so that their activities are monitored. And the teacher should have maximum space to monitor each child. Teacher should make sure that he or she has enough seats to accommodate the class. So, what is conducive and conducive emotional and social environment? Environment begins with the room and extends to the behavior of the teacher as well as students. We don't mean only physical environment but emotional and social environment also. The teacher should establish an atmosphere that respects all differences in individuals. Students have opportunity to feel capable, connected and contributing members of the school. Students should be encouraged to become actively involved in their school and classroom activities. It becomes necessary for the teacher to take following steps to ensure that classroom is inviting and welcoming students. Number one, greeting program. Teacher greeting every student by name at the classroom door makes the child more comfortable. It means the teacher should be in greeting mode. She or he should greet every student who comes in the classroom. Newcomer club. The newcomer club should be welcome and involved in school and classroom activities. Changing seats to create a classroom environment that enhance emotional and social relationships. Changing seats frequently is very important. This allows a student to work with different classmates and make new friends. This also promotes social interaction and emotional bonding among them. One-to-one contact. Teacher should interact individually with every child to make him feel free, comfortable, and more confident. Peer reading program. Seniors should provide reading and other assistance to juniors. Anti-discrimination policy should also be there. Teacher should develop anti-discrimination policy on factors like gender, family status, religion, age, etc. for giving healthy socio-emotional environment. It will ensure positive learning to students. Teacher can also ask for or narrate true stories of relatives, friends, their achievements and problems, etc. Teacher should not let any child feel inferior. Now, what will be the health instructions? To inspire the child with a desire to be well and happy is possible only through health instructions about food, balanced diet, diseases, postures and healthy habits, etc. Let's discuss about food and balanced diet. Any edible substance which one eats and which provides material or materials useful for the body of a living being can be termed as food. Many sources of food are plants and animals. Green plants prepare their own food with the help of sunlight, air, water, and mineral from the soil. They provide us cereals, pulses, vegetables, fruits, sugar, vegetable oil, spices, nuts, and beverages. Animals provide us food in the form of milk, meat, egg, fish, and honey. Food helps us to grow, keeps us healthy also. The food supplies the energy for every action we undertake, from eating banana to running a race. It also protects us from diseases. Our food should have all the nutrients like carbohydrates, fats, proteins, vitamins, etc. Nutrients also provides energy to the body to work and play. We can classify nutrients as carbohydrates, fats, proteins, minerals, etc. Now let's discuss the examples of these nutrients. Number one, carbohydrate. It is the energy giving food. Its sources are wheat, rice, potato, sugar, mango, banana, etc. The examples of fats are ghee, butter, orange, nuts, etc. The examples of proteins are vegetables, pulses, cheese, egg, milk, fish, etc. Mineral salt. Its sources are milk, cheese, green leafy vegetables, pulses, etc. The sources of vitamins are fruits, vegetables, egg, milk, etc. And we get roughage from salad, vegetables, and fruits. It helps in digestive system also. Now let's discuss about water. It is also a very important nutrient which our body needs, and it also helps for the working of our body also. What is balanced diet? A balanced diet, it is important that we consume all nutrients, but it is equally important that we consume them in adequate manner. That is what makes our diet a balanced diet. So, a balanced diet can be defined as, it is one which contains all the nutrients in proper amount according to age and work we do. No single food item offers all the nutrients required by the body. Only a combination of different food items in adequate quantity will form a balanced diet. Balanced diet implies a complete meal. Factors affecting balanced diet are age, sex, body size, eating habits and social customs, climate factors, health status and growth, and psychological factors also. We must understand that people at different age and conditions need different nutrients in different quantities. Growing children need more proteins to build their body. Infants need more of vitamins and proteins to build their bodies and to keep diseases away. Nursing mothers and pregnant women also need more of protein to serve the need of a growing baby. A hard-working laborer who does a lot of physical work needs more of carbohydrate and fats to get energy. There are hundreds of items that we eat, but our diet must include foodstuffs from the following groups. Number one, milk group, which includes milk, cheese, and other milk products. Second group is meat group, which includes chicken, fish, lamb, etc. For non-vegetarians and for vegetarians, soya beans, beans, peas, grams, nuts and seeds, etc. are the sources of meat group. Now, next group is fruit and vegetable soups. It includes all kinds of vegetables and fruits. Next, cereals and wheat group. It includes wheat, rice and other cereals also. Now, let's discuss about the diseases that is divided into two categories. Number one is communicable diseases and non-communicable diseases. So it is necessary to stay fit and free from diseases because it leaves a person very weak, and prolonged disease results in death. Disease may be result of infection, sometimes heredity and sometimes deficiency disease. In this lesson, you will study about disease which occurs due to infection in our body. First, I would like to explain the meaning of disease. Disease is a state of discomfort in which the normal functioning of body is disturbed. Some of the common diseases are malaria, typhoid, chicken pox, eye flu, etc. What are the causes of its spread? We are probably thinking that communicable diseases is communicated by air or touch, but there are other modes too. These diseases spread through air, water, food, and contact. You know that germs are present everywhere around us and they can spread through four modes. Number one, food and water, air, contact, and insects. So how it can be communicated through food and water? The uncovered food and water get contaminated with germs and unhygienic preparation, serving and storing dirty hands and utensils and dirty surroundings also help in contaminating food and water and spreading disease. How it can be communicated through air? Whenever a person suffering from disease like influenza, measles, etc., coughs, speaks or sneezes, his germs enters a healthy person when he breathes in and likely to catch the disease. And how the disease can be communicated through contact? It may spread through direct contact, that is when we touch the person having disease, and indirect contact when we use anything already used by him like towel, cup, handkerchief, etc. Insects can also communicate diseases from one person to another. Like flies also carry germs from garbage on their bodies and infect the food on which they sit. This causes cholera, and mosquitoes causes malaria. Let's discuss the difference between communicable and non-communicable disease. Disease which spreads from person to person is known as communicable disease. These diseases are also known as infectious diseases like mumps, measles, tuberculosis, AIDS, cold, cough, eye flu, etc. For example, a healthy person can catch cold anytime. If a disease does not spread from one person to another, it is said to be non-communicable disease, like blood pressure, diabetes, heart stroke, etc. These are the examples of non-communicable disease. For example, if a mother is having high blood pressure, the child is not going to have it by infection. So here's a chart of the communicable disease. And we have discussed here the name of the disease, the mode, how it spreads, the symptoms of this, and preventions we can take to avoid the diseases, and the treatments also. You can have a close look on this. We have covered chickenpox, measles, whooping cough, tuberculosis. Number one, smallpox, its mode of transfer is air, direct contact. The symptoms of smallpox is fever, headache, vomiting, and rashes. And how we prevent it? We can prevent the smallpox by antibody production. And treatment is, we can keep the person who is affecting from smallpox in isolation, and proper medication should be there also for him or her. So in this kind, we have discussed many diseases. Now let's come to the preventive measures. We can avoid diseases in many ways. We can cure them, but before curing the disease, we have to take few preventions also. Like, we can keep the water in clean and covered utensils. Boil water and milk before using it. All food, even leftover meals, vegetables, fruits, sweets, milk should be kept covered. Avoid eating and buying cut fruits and vegetables. Wash all utensils before using them. Wash your hands before cooking and eating food. Keep the house and place of work well ventilated. Avoid crowded place during an epidemic. Maintain personal hygiene like regular bath, nail cutting, clean and cut short, wash hair regularly, etc. Keep houses and surroundings clean. Do not spit anywhere and everywhere. Use handkerchief to cover nose and mouth while coughing, and immunize your children also. Now let's come to the very important part of this chapter, that is postures. A posture is an intentionally or habitually assumed position. It is a general term for a configuration of the human body. A good posture optimizes breathing and affects the circulation of body fluid. Meaning of posture. It is hard to define posture, but a good posture may be defined as the best posture is that in which the body segments are balanced in a position of least strain and maximum support. The basic posture of a human body are standing, sitting, lying. These are the very common postures. A human always can stand during a day, he or she can sit or lie in the night. But there should be a proper posture for doing all these things. When one stands, while standing, maintain a straight spine, avoid slouching forward, keep the knees slightly bent, wear comfortable footwear and avoid standing for long. When one sits, one should sit with back straight and shoulders back. Keep your feet flat on the floor, avoid sitting more than 30 seconds. While lying, try to sleep in a position which helps you maintain the curve in your back. Select a firm mattress. Postural deformities and cure. Now, let's discuss if we don't maintain a good posture, we can face certain postural deformities like kyphosis. It is an increased amount of normal convexity. It is the unnatural curvature of the spine. It results in excessive rounding. As you can see in this picture, and obviously there is a cure for the kyphosis also. It can be cured by strengthening the extensor muscles and improving their tonus. Lordosis, next postural defect. It increases the amount of the normal concavity of the lumbar region of the spine. We have shown in the given picture both postural defects, that is kyphosis and lordosis. The cure for lordosis is it can cure by developing strength in the abdominal muscle and exercising to control the position of pelvis. The third postural defect is scoliosis. It is the sideward deviation of the spine with shoulder lower and hip higher on one. As it is visible in the feature, the spine has a curve on the left side. Its cure is one can be cured by hanging oneself from hands using body weight, developing strength in spinal extensor through exercise. Next one, the postural defect is called flat foot. If the arch is resting on the supporting surface, the foot is classified as flat foot. As it is visible in the picture, a healthy foot you can easily differentiate and a flat foot. The cure for flat foot is One should rise on his or her toes, climbing stairs on the toes, rope and skipping and cycling. Next defect is knock knee. Knock knee is a condition in which the knees touch but the ankles do not touch. As it is visible in the picture, there are two types of legs given. Number one is that is knock knee, a postural defect, and the normal legs. The cure for knock knee is it can be cured by standing on a woolen curved plank and do sit-ups 5 to 7 a day by cycling and opening knees in V-shape, placing a pillow between legs while sleeping. Let's discuss about a habit. What is a habit? We can say habit is a repeated regular behavior that occurs subconsciously. Healthy habits can have large impact on our health. The more healthy habit we follow, the more we protect our body from degradation and disease. If we want to lead a long life and feel better, we should adopt healthy habits like getting into regular physical activity, eating healthy, etc. We have given the examples of healthy habits and unhealthy habits here. Certain list is given in the business picture. Healthy habits are getting enough sleep, punctuality, discipline, eating healthy habits, positive thinking. The unhealthy habits are eating junk food, carelessness, negative thinking, use of tobacco, wine, etc., unhygienic environment, nail biting, etc. So learners, today we have covered many important topics of health and physical education. Like we have covered the healthful school environment, how we can keep the school environment healthy, and we have also discussed the importance of balanced diet, the healthy habits, and most importantly about the postures and the postural defects. Hope this lecture will be beneficial for you, and we will meet you in the next lecture. Thank you.